everybody to the top eight. The top eight that we're going to talk about this week is Legacy, top eight decks in Legacy. And, you know, this format's definitely been shaken up a lot because of the addition of course, Treasure Cruise and Digging
Yeah,
Time.
Before cons, this list would have looked very different.
Although
yeah.
This list, I think, is a pre-cons list almost. Is that,
no.
Like, this ordering seems insane to me, but we'll get there.
Well, do you agree that number one?
Number one is number
one.
Okay,
all
right. We'll get to the right spot.
We'll get to it. But anywho, let's just go over to the list here. And we have coming in at number eight, we have Reanimator.
Yeah.
So...
I mean, Reanimator is just a really good deck because it's so fast, and it matches up well against a lot of other combo decks because you get to play like all of the interactive spells, and you're just a super fast deck.
So explain how exactly this Reanimator deck works in Legacy.
So the ideal draw is you just go like turn one, Entomb, get a Gristlebrand into your graveyard. Turn two, you cast Reanimate or Exhume or Animate Dead on the Gristlebrand, bring it back into play. Then you get to draw a bunch of cards. You have Force of Wills and Dazes, so you just counter whatever your opponent does, and then you kill them with this Gristlebrand.
What makes this better than, like, for example, Show and Tell?
Basically because your spells cost less. Your deck is just faster and a lot better against things like Spell Pierce and Daze because your spells are so cheap.
Okay.
Your gold is faster.
Yeah.
Okay.
The downside is that you're vulnerable to more hate because you use the graveyard.
Yep.
You open yourself up to all of the graveyard hate.
I see.
Yeah, the biggest difference here, I mean, having access to black mana means you can play Duress and Thoughtseize, which are just great cards in a lot of matchups. A lot of your bad matchups if Sneak and Show could like play those cards for free, it certainly would, right? Because you want to proactively kind of strip their one card.
Force of Will or whatever.
Yeah, having to play like Spell Pierce instead is a lot worse.
Way worse.
Because you just need an extra
turn.
You need an extra mana on the turn you're going.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like Storm does the same thing, right?
Exactly.
Thoughtseize just to fight through the disruption.
Yep.
Because it can't afford to play it.
And that's the big reason why I think Storm is such a good combo deck. Because it gets to play those cards. Same thing with Reanimator.
Of course. Okay, so that was our number eight, Reanimator. Coming at number seven, which had it been a different time, I feel like this would have been higher up on the list. But number seven, we have Elves. So what are your thoughts on this
I mean, I used to think that Elves was just the best deck in the format. I liked it against every blue deck, barring like tons and tons of hate cards for the matchup. And it was soft to like combo decks, but beat all the fair decks. And now I don't think it beats the fair decks, so it's no longer something I'm interested in playing because it loses to all the blue decks and all the combo decks now.
You were championing the Elf decks for
Legacy. I played it for like a year straight in Legacy.
Yeah, I think Elves was, I had it at number three. We did this list before.
Right.
And I agree, it's definitely moved out a lot. Also, the cards people are now playing, you're seeing way more Pyroclasms. Inside boards,
electric and forked bolts.
Yeah,
like,
people are just preparing.
Like
now.
So many of the things that are good against the blue red Delver deck are accidentally good against you, which is really bad.
That just has all one tough as well.
Right. The one upside though for a deck like Elves is that decks are playing like main deck cards like main deck Pyroblast, main deck Reb. So you're getting better in those. But like your game one's not where the issue is. It's that they all have so much tangential sideboard hate for you.
Right.
And they can power through drawing one dead card with cards like Treasure Cruise, like Wrapter mentioned. So
also
I agree that...
Brainstorm.
Brainstorm shuffled away. So it's a forgiving format for drawing a couple dead cards.
Yeah.
And I think Elves has certainly gotten a lot worse.
Yeah, that makes sense. I bet Matt Nash...
Swiss Spear specifically, more than Treasure Cruise, possibly is like the downfall of Elves also. Like
the clocks are so fast now.
Yeah. Like before, like... Yeah, Swiss Spear is just an incredibly fast clock.
Oh, yeah.
Racing, like, dealing with a Tarmogoyf, it's just so easy to, like that. That's really slow.
Yeah.
Swiss Spear is so much faster.
It's a one-minute Tarmogoyf.
Yep.
Yeah, with haste.
No big deal. Yeah.
Do you think it's possible that this will, Swift Spear, like, do you think Swift Spear might be better than Delver of Secrets as the one drop?
Yes.
Is it the best one drop?
Oh, it's not even close. Like,
yeah, not
Swift Spear is just better, yeah.
So Swift Spear is the best one drop in Legacy?
Yes.
Is it the best one drop, period?
In all of the history of Magic?
I guess in Vintage you have, like, Welder, but...
Like the best one-drops in Legacy are... You have Mother of Runes, and you have Swift Spear, and there aren't really any other... I guess Elves plays a wide variety, but they're, like...
Yeah.
They're locally powerful, they're clearly not, like, objectively powerful Magic cards. Like, Nettle Sentinel's, like, a great Magic card, just happens to be great in that deck.
Swift Spear is probably better than Delver in Vintage, also.
So prior
Delver, not even good Vintage.
Yeah. Well, but there's decks in Vintage that are playing Delver right now. They
so
don't
prior,
play Swift Spear.
Prior to printing,
they probably would be better if they just played Swift Spear.
You have to do more to warp your deck though if you're going to play Swift Spear. You certainly have to be.
Do you?
Yeah, because like Delver, you
I mean, the Delver deck is so reactive. I guess.
And like the Swift Spear card, like you have to pump it every turn, so you need to be playing burn spells. It's not like
the thing is like you don't. You only need to pump it once every turn. If it's just a two power creature, it's better than Delver, right?
No.
We definitely
one mana 2/3
because you're going to miss sometimes.
Yeah.
No, if it was just a 1-mana 2/3 haste, that's better than
Delver. Yes, agreed. Well, I think that Goblin Guide might be better than Delver. And Goblin Guide without a drawback is going to be...
Well, yeah.
We definitely did best 1-mana creatures, but this was Pirate of the Spear, and number one was Delver.
Yeah.
So now, Delver, scooch aside.
Swiss Maybe.
You have to do way more work.
In Legacy right now, I think it's clear that Swiss Spear is better.
But Taylor, we're going to get there, so we'll talk more about this in a little bit.
Definitely. Now, coming in at number 6, this is a deck that nobody ever wants to play against. It's just really, really annoying to play against.
I feel like a lot of people really want to play against this.
It's really annoying to play against, and I feel like not a lot of the good players actually play this deck, but for some reason, it just still like puts up results in... Like, I would never play a deck like this, but I don't know. It just got like the right combination of hate cards, and it can just like be a real pain to play against. But coming in number 6, we have Death and Taxes.
Yeah, I think this might be the best deck in Legacy right now. I would have this in the top 3 for sure.
Yeah, I couldn't get behind that. Yeah, I think the deck is actually very good.
I think it can also
if
be built.
It's a top 3 deck that people don't want to play against it, right?
Well, any combo player wants to play against this. Well, not Sneak and Show, I guess. But like a Storm player wants to play against it.
So explain how Death and Taxes works for people who don't
play. So it's a white weenie deck with Mother of Runes, Aether Vial, and then a bunch of like hate creatures like Thalia. What are other common ones that play?
Now it's Containment Priest.
Well, Containment Priest certainly. Like, that's a good one.
With Flickerwisps. Which I think is a really powerful interaction.
Is Containment Priest the main deck card in this deck?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Does it play Wasted Tutor up these creatures, or do you think it's just going to play like three
priests? It just plays three priests. Oh, okay. If you're playing four Flickerwisps, that's just a powerful interaction. Like, those two cards really work well, because you just perm their guy.
Yeah, it's just your Flickerwisp becomes kill a creature when it comes in play.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. So I think, as long as the Containment Priest is still in play at the end of the turn, obviously, but...
Yeah.
I think that depending on how the format shakes out, this deck also has access to like a lot of the very powerful sideboard cards that are white in Legacy, so it has access to all of those.
Yeah, normally your white weenie deck doesn't get a good sideboard, but this one actually has like an excellent one, and there's nothing it's particularly weak to. Like, it's good against other people's sideboards too. Like,
there are
certain cards like Sulfur Elemental.
Is it good against Delver?
I think if it can be built the way where it is, then I think it's a top 3 deck.
Will it play Core Firewalkers in the sideboard?
Yeah, definitely. Three of them.
Potentially main, like, could.
If you're expecting, like, 40% of the field to be Blue Red Devil, which
is that's just not realistic at all. But
what do you think is a realistic number?
15, 20?
Yeah.
That's
15. That's 15 is, like, huge. More than any deck in Legacy has ever gotten in a tournament before.
Way more.
And this term has been, like, so huge that, like...
How many Delver decks in the top 8? 4, 5?
2 or 3.
Okay. So that's just a testament to like just how open the format is, right? Like,
I mean, I think Delver will outperform, you know, relative to a random deck. So there's going to be more skewed at the top.
Right.
But certainly, the percentage of the field is actually not going to be that large.
So there you have it. You know, if you want to build your deck to beat some of the top decks, Death and Taxes might be one of the best. Coming at number 5, this is consider one of the best decks in the past. Maybe it's gotten a little bit weaker, but still good enough to make the list. We have Sneak and Show.
Yeah, I don't think it's actually gotten weaker.
Oh, yeah.
This is like a great home for Dig Through Time. It's excellent at playing that card. And it, like the things that have gotten better are not bad matchups for this deck, necessarily. Okay. I don't know that they're good, but... I mean, I guess the Delver decks have gotten just like so much better that matchup has gotten worse, but it might still be okay.
Like, how fast like they is don't the Delver act deck?
Like the thing is like Delver decks cut a lot of their interactive elements for the Treasure Cruisers and whatnot. Like you don't see Spell Pierce in your Delver decks anymore, which is one of the best cards in the head to head.
I actually don't like Dig Through Time in this deck very much because it slows you down a lot to get it turned on for that critical turn. And you have enough Ponder and Brainstorm are good enough at finding the one card you're missing. You don't need to go dig. I think I don't think that you really want a lot of copies of that card. Okay. You could. I don't think you want them in this deck. I think you want to build the deck as aggressively and as fast as you can, and you want to just advance your game state.
Because you're trying to race like all these other super fast decks.
You're doing something very powerful, and the appeal to the deck is like when you get to go, you know, turn one, Ancient Tomb, Lotus Petal, Show and Tell, and those are your kind of draws you can have, or you can.
Yeah, you can still have those. Like you still have the access to those draws if you build it in a more controlling way. And this is the combo deck that like most lends itself to being able to play like a control game with a lot of interactive cards.
Are you cutting creatures? If you cut some number of your guys.
You'd have to be cutting some stuff, right?
You have to cut creatures. You can't play 4 Emrakul and 4 Grizzlebrand and then also try to be like a good control deck. Because you 4 Emrakul, 4 Grizzlebrand, 4 Show and Tell, 4 Sneak Attack.
Yeah, so.
Those cards are not good.
Easier access to those cards when you need them, like.
But Dig Through Time is like you have to be like later in the game. I don't think that's the direction you want to go with this deck. I think it does not actually play well in the control shell. I think it plays really well in the tempo. I'm going to kill you, and I'm going to have enough on the critical turn that I'm actually going to go off and kill you. It's really good at it's the best deck at forcing through its plan on turn three. And it gets much worse if you try, make the game go longer than that.
Okay. So
why does it get much worse playing a longer game?
Because you just have a lot of cards in your hand that are redundant and clog up your hand. And, like, you can sculpt a good hand, but, like...
So Sneaky Show doesn't play, like, a good long game, right? Just because, like, you don't have too many
control I think it does.
Okay.
I think it plays an okay long game, but, like, it's things like, for instance, when you're trying to set up, like, a perfect turn three hand, right? Like, you're pondering and you're trying to find, like, the one great card, like, the card you need, right? So... But you're often going to ponder and see, like, Embercold, Gristlebrand land, and you need one creature, so you keep those on top. Now your next two draw steps are dead. Like, those sort of situations happen, I think, a lot with this sort of a deck, right? Because you want to find one of each thing.
Uh-huh.
And so it makes your, like, it makes a card like Ponder a lot worse if you're trying to play a longer game, and your cards are, like, very redundant.
I mean, you can, first of all, you can just play, like, Preordain instead, if that's an issue.
Sure.
Which...
That's potentially, I mean...
Sees one less card for going off, like, immediately, but it solves that issue with Ponder, right?
So if you guys are wondering where we got a lot of this information to make a top 8 list, a lot of this information was actually based off of Bob Hoang's top 8, Bob Hoang's Legacy Primer.
Mm-hmm.
He just wrote a nice long article just discussing all the decks in Legacy, so you should definitely go to the website, check it out, if you guys just kind of want a breakdown of just how all the decks work. Because I don't play a lot of Legacy, so something like that would be very helpful
for
me.
Yeah, that was a great article.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's that. There's also actually recently a Reddit post, which kind of just analyzes off of each land they play on turn one, what are they probably playing? Which I'd also recommend people to check out if you're trying to get exposed to Legacy, because it was really well done.
Okay.
I think those two combined are a great primer on Legacy.
Exactly.
And also Caleb's article, who may still have the author correct, from last week.
It might be Caleb, but it could just be somebody else.
It should be Caleb.
Well, Reed Duke wrote an article on Miracles.
He did. He wrote a good Miracles article as well.
Yeah, okay.
Analyzed the three types of that. So this gives you lots of coverage of Legacy.
Yeah. All right, so that was Sneak and Show. Coming in at number four, we just... touched on a little bit earlier, we have Storm. What do you think, Tom?
See, I think this is the better jam it on turn two or three combo deck than Sneak and Show.
But it because it plays cards like Duress and Cabal there, I think this is actually the one that doesn't have to jam it as much. It's a little bit interesting. So the cards like Treasures and Dig Through Time sort of make discard worse, right? Because you're basically turning their card into a Lotus Petal in some sense, and you're playing against those decks. So it makes you less inclined to play cards like that. But you need those cards to beat this deck. Like, you're not beating Storm consistently if you're not playing discard spells, I think. Because it's just so resilient and so redundant. And I think it is much better to set to play the longer game.
I mean, I don't think there's a big difference between a discard spell and a spell pierce in the matchup. Like, a discard spell is better because you don't have to, like, sit there with one mana.
Does Storm play the Treasure Cruise cards?
I think functionally they're pretty close.
No.
Okay.
It doesn't have room. I mean, Storm's all about trying to set up the
also plays Ad Nauseam.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Very bad.
Those cards are really bad at Ad Nauseam.
Yeah.
I think Storm is a very good deck right now. I think it's one of the hardest decks to play, though.
Yes.
I've tried to play it, and there are just too many lines. And
it's like pretty easy to kind of get a read for like your opponent, too, because like they have to do all the math in their head, you know?
Right.
But like, you can't do it instantly. So like you just sit there, and you're just like, you know, and you're like, all right, what can he have? Like, so unless you play the deck a ton and just know all the numbers right away, all of a sudden you're just like, all right, I'm going to have... 5 mana, 6 storm count, and then I have to hit something.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it feels like it might not be the best deck to play. But, I mean, wasn't that kind of the case with, it's not on the list, but, like, a deck like High Tide? Is that a difficult deck to play?
Yeah, the deck's super hard to play.
Yeah.
I think, like, the main Storm line, where it's just like, I'm going to build a bunch of stuff, I'm going to play an Infernal Tutor, I'm going to sack an LED in response, that line's, like, really simple.
Okay.
But figuring out what you can play around and how to do that is
very figuring out how to play around things with this deck is really hard to do.
Right, because sometimes you're trying to bait counters. You're like, all right, this time I have a bunch of rituals,
yeah.
So I'm going to be like, not play my land, play my ritual, hope he counters it, then play my land and then combo off.
Yeah.
Or, like, try to get them to counter the wrong things. Because there's going to be a lot of forcibles in this tournament.
Well, also, the good thing, forcibles bad against, like,
Delver?
I'm actually not good. Forceful historically has been really bad against Delver. It's possible now that everyone's playing Treasure Cruise, Forceful is actually good, and you leave it in those matchups. That's what I'm trying to figure out still.
I think that is true.
Yeah. It's very possible that sideboarding plans and mindsets need to change a lot.
It's like 2-for-1 yourself is better than them getting the 3-for-1.
Absolutely.
Well, also, it's like, it's not even the Force Will or the Treasure Cruise that you have to Force Will. If you can just, like, Force Will their 1-drop because your deck has Treasure Cruises in it now, like, you can reload. Like, it makes tempo way more important than card advantage.
Right.
Like, now, that card just exists.
The one thing about Storm compared to Sneak and Show is that it actually dodges what I think is going to be the most prevalent sideboard card, which is everyone's packing between 4 and, like, 6 Red Blasts. And Red Blast is not good against Storm.
Right.
Like,
I mean, you bring it in.
You do.
But, you counter their Brainstorm with it. That's relevant.
I don't think you bring. So I was playing a lot with the blue white red Stormblade deck, and I imagine, like I mentioned, I keep playing against Storm, and I had tons of games where I'm sitting with just two Pyroblasts in my hand. And like
they're playing all these black spells, and you're just like
it doesn't do anything.
On the turn they're going off, it doesn't do anything.
It does nothing.
It does counter their, like, being able to go one for one with their set of spells is generally very good for the
good,
blue deck.
Yes, but
does that warrant bringing in like all six copies?
Exactly? No, you would not
want that many.
You want like,
and
like
so,
2 to 4 whereas, somewhere around there.
Whereas against
you could probably bring in four. Like the thing is, like, you normally have a lot of dead cards against Storm because.
Yeah.
You have, you know, all these removal spells you need to cut.
Yeah.
So you're like, anything in your sideboard that does anything, you're going to bring in.
Right.
Is usually how it goes.
I had four or five of them in my 75, and they were earmarked for like, it's like an anti-combo card. It's good in Sneak and Show. It's like the best card against Sneak and Show. But it's not good here. So when people are thinking, I have X slots for combo, I'm going to devote several of them to Rebs. Your matchups are going to get a lot better.
Start playing some Fluster Storms.
So Fluster Storm is certainly better here, but Fluster Storm is actually not that great against Sneak and Show.
Yeah.
Okay. I see. So that's number four. We have Storm. Now we're moving into our top three. Coming at number three, Miracles.
This deck was the best deck in Legacy at some point over the last 6 months, I think. Mm-hmm. I'm not even going to the top three right now. I know you're not either.
Yeah, I don't like the deck at all anymore.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think Counterbalance top, it was too slow. Like,
see, theoretically, it seems good. Like, obviously, if you have turn one top, turn two Counterbalance, like, theoretically... Get, you know, if you can try to lock out like a blue red Delver player,
yes,
they can cast as many Treasure Cruises as they want. They're never going to cast any relevant spells for them.
Yeah, like Counterbalance lock is still absurd,
right?
But getting
it's
the game
to
state to that point is very difficult. You don't have the problem is you don't have the time to dig around with your tops anymore.
Okay,
at all.
Yeah. It's just like you just can't afford to be sinking mana into that.
And also, it's just hard to resolve a turn two Counterbalance. Like, these decks have 4 days and 4 Force of Will. And they have, like... They
and Red Blast, like, there's going to be so many Red Blasts that, like, that just makes Counterbalance a lot worse.
Yeah. Like, on the draw, I think this, like, you just... It's a pipe dream to try to be locking out, like, a Delver deck with this... Like I said, I this is the first deck I went to when thinking about how to set up for this tournament, and I didn't counter a single card with Counterbalance over, like, 10 or 12 matches. It was absurd.
Just some blind flips? Yes!
The card doesn't resolve or just doesn't do enough, and it just... I don't know. I was really shocked at how poorly I was doing with this deck against Delver.
Okay.
And I thought, like, that should be a great matchup, and I just wasn't winning.
Yeah, I know. I mean, Reed Duke posted an article about it, too. He's like, hey, maybe there's Miracles is a way to get go over the top of these Delver decks just because you got cheap Wraths, and you can potentially lock them out with. But you guys are saying that despite that being powerful, it's just
too inefficient,
yeah.
I think.
Like, Miracles preyed upon... So I thought Miracles' best matchup was like, Stoneblade. That's the matchup I did not want to play.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's basically Miracles, while it still has... These Terminus in its deck, that's its concession to creatures. Terminus isn't even actually that bad against Stoneblade, and it has cards that can treat the Angels, which is absurd, and it has Counterbalance top, which actually is good in that match because the matchup's slow enough.
Slower, yeah.
But now that, like, the Stoneblade decks are getting worse because they can't keep up with the Delver decks, Miracles is, like, it's a good matchup, probably, like, Elves, which is also probably a great matchup for Miracles.
Yeah,
And those decks are just getting less prevalent.
Okay.
So
Miracles definitely a better deck in a slightly slower format where, like, people aren't killing you on turn 5 or 6 or whatever.
It is going to be good against, like, the other blue decks that are trying to,
beat
like...
the Delver decks.
Yeah, the more controlling blue decks, like, Miracles is going to be good against those.
Yeah, the Jeskai Stoneblade deck that won the SCG Open.
Yeah, so if the format ends up looking like everybody just starts playing Stoneblade because that's the deck that beats Delver,
it's all about,
like...
the layers.
Yeah, yeah.
How many levels are you willing
well,
to
Well, the
right?
thing is, you can't actually go to the levels in Legacy because it's not like Standard where it changes super quickly in reaction to things. Like, Legacy, the format stays, like, people just play their decks.
Yeah.
So, like... Delver's never going to grow up to, like,
out.
You know, 30% of the field to get to the point where you can metagame against Delver specifically and play your Stoneblade deck.
Right.
You'll play Delver three times this tournament, you know, assuming you play all 15 rounds or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And I think, like, also if you think about the way the levels stack, right, so you have, like, blue-red Delver, and then say you want to beat that, so you're going to play, like, blue-red Delver.
Yeah.
If you want to beat that, you could play Miracles, but you also just play Esper Stoneblade, which also beats Blue Red Delver, but has better matchups at the field than the Miracles does.
Right.
No bias
assuming
here.
That people won't be playing. I play the deck a ton, but Miracles beats that deck, but I don't think people will be playing Miracles. It's kind of like, where do you want to slot in the hierarchy, and where do you want to get the trade-offs and the matchups? And
okay.
I don't know. I think playing a control deck in this format given how punishing the aggro draws are, is going to be dangerous.
Yeah, but then you could also just play against the right matchups, and you could see an Oracle deck do well.
But that could happen with any deck.
That could happen with any deck, that's true. Every deck is
any deck on this list could easily make top 8 and say, okay, sure, that's
even Death and Taxes.
Even Death and Taxes. Hey, that's a top
3. Even White Weenie.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so that was Miracles. Coming at number 2, we've also been talking about this deck quite a bit. We have Stoneblade and all of its Stoneblade variants. We're talking about Esper Stoneblade, Jeskai Stoneblade, maybe Jeskai Stoneblade because it won the last Open tournament.
So. Also, just straight blue-white is also a deck that you see, that sees play.
Okay. So explain how like the Stoneblade deck works and why is it one of the best decks in the format?
Sure. So it's just a solid blue deck playing all the good blue cards and Stoneforge Mystic to give it like a good long game plan. Basically, it leans on the equipment in Batterskull and Jit to... like be able to, it just wins long games with those cards.
Okay. Yeah, I mean having the trump plan of Mystic into Batterskull as your answer to aggro decks is huge, right? Because it just gives you this clock that gains you life and they can't catch up, so it lets you claw back into games that you're otherwise losing. And then specifically with the Esper version, right? You actually have enough disruption that you have a great game against the combo decks because you have discard with like Thoughtseize and potentially Inquisition of Kozilek or even Duress. And so that gives you a lot of disruption against them. The blue white red version is foregoing that disruption to get more removal spells, right? Because it realized that you can no longer just rely on Mystic for Batterskull because the blue red double decks plays so much burn that they're gonna be able to kill it, and even more burn than like Rug Delver for instance played, right? Rug Delver had some burn, but it often couldn't kill the Stoneforge Mystic.
Right.
And then if once you do kill it, like the game would go long against Rug Delver, you'd just find time, you'd kill their one Goyf, and you could get the 5 lands.
Right.
But the Rug Delver is just playing treasure goes and just killing you. So the format's gotten fast enough now that actually it trumps Stoneforge Mystic. And Jit, you never have time to equip, right? Like Jit, I think, is actually bad now. Because there's just nothing you can put it on.
It's just format.
Yeah, I mean, you need something like Lingering Souls.
You actually probably need True Name Nemesis now. Yeah. Like, the benefit before, again, was that if you cast Lingering Souls, you equip it once, they kill it, but who cares, you equip the other one. But now it's like you equip it once, they kill it, and then they kill you that turn. So now you actually have to have True Nemesis.
You're just
you need to have Resilient
You're
Threat.
Just way too behind if you're spending 2 mana and then they just like
use one mana.
Yes.
Yeah. That is kind of going back to the Miracle deck. That's why it's no longer as good because spending a mana to use that top is really costly.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. You just can't afford to be dirtling around in this format anymore.
And the other issue with the Delver deck is if you look at its sideboard, they're all sideboarding cards like Smash of Tithereans, which is such a blow because you basically a lot of times have to cross your fingers and just jam the Batterskull and hope they can't kill it that turn. And so when they smash it, you just have no way to come back. And they also play Sulfuric Vortex, which is tremendous against this deck as well.
So then if people are kind of like, you know, so many people are playing like this blue-red Delver deck or playing a deck with a lot of removal spells, doesn't that make the Stoneblade deck much worse? Like, because you're relying on your Stoneforge Mystic, but then...
But in most matchups you're like that aren't super fast, you're totally okay with your Stoneforge dying.
Yeah, you don't
care. Cuz you've gotten value out of it. You've gotten your end game out of it already. You're still just going to play the Batterskull and win with that.
Okay.
Oftentimes you actually hope that they just counter your Stoneforge Mystic. Like people force it all the time and I'm usually like excited.
Well, that's great cuz now all my other Stoneforges are now live.
Right.
Because, yeah, after the first one, then, like, the other one is just...
You cast it, you expect it to get swords, they're bolted, and you're fine with that. And then you just have the thing tucked away that eventually will come back and grind out some advantage. But it's you don't win a lot of games by, like, turn 2 Stoneforge, turn 3 Batterskull, and that actually, like, wins the game. That never happens.
Yeah.
So is Stoneblade still, you think, a good choice to play in the current metagame?
I love it against all the non-Delver decks. That I'm seeing, like, I mean, I've played, like I said, a lot of Magic.
Well, you're talking about the Esper version, where you're
Esper
just
version.
Playing a bunch of discard spells.
Yes.
Right.
Whereas, like, the blue-white red... my problem with the deck is that it has, like, the classic mid-range deck problem of you need to draw the right cards in the right matchups. Like, if you build the deck with a bunch of, like, bolts and swords, then you're going to be good against the Delver decks, but you're going to be not good against combo, you're not going to be good against control.
It's like Jund.
Yeah.
When you play Jund.
Yeah. And if you build it like Tom does with a bunch of discard spells and Lingering Souls, like, you're going to be good against, you know, combo, you're going to be good against the control decks, or at least better there, but, like, that deck just doesn't beat the Delver decks then.
Yeah, not anymore.
But at least the Hand Disruption spells are a little more versatile, because it just gets anything.
But, like,
you know?
Yeah,
but
the problem is that you're spending a mana
to
not impact the board.
Right, and that's just
If they go turn one Swift Spear and you go turn one Thoughtseize, you're just dead. Like, you're not winning those games. That's the real problem. And the other issue is, like...
I mean, the reason you're not winning those games is because by going Thoughtseize, that means you don't have a removal spell in your hand, so you're
going to
die.
You're
like, you're not dying because you have Thoughtseize, you're dying because you don't have removal.
So one point on that, though, like, you talk about how it has a classic mid-range problem of, like, you need to draw the right cards at the right time. Well, Legacy is actually a good format for that with Brainstorm, and I play a lot of Ponders as well. Mm-hmm. So actually,
it used to be that was totally fine.
That was enough time.
You can play your blue deck, and you can just, yeah.
Like, if they go turn one Swisspear, and you go, like, Ponder, and then they
it's
go, like,
all right, next turn,
yeah,
four.
Yeah.
Now
they're just going to play, like, another guy, and you just can't get back in.
And then the other problem is, like, when you cast a card like Ponder, you're choosing, you're prioritizing finding cards like Swords of Pleasures, and then you don't have the answer to the Treasure Cruise. Like, when you're playing your card selection cards, you can't keep your hand full of both. That's the other issue, right? A lot of times you'll play a turn on Ponder, and you're like, or you'll brainstorm and have to shuffle something away. It's like, do I shuffle away this Supreme Verdict or this Force of Will? And you don't know yet, because it's like you had to dig for this Swords of Pleasures. You have to decide. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing I'm finding a lot, is that you don't know what kind of hand context they have. And you either can lose a Treasure Cruise or lose to, like, a backup creature.
Yep.
And it's so hard to play that predictive game.
In conclusion, Delver's a sweet deck. So, of course, to nobody's surprise, we'll go straight into our number one, the top dog in all of Legacy, which is, of course, Delver and all of its variants, but I think...
Just Blue-Red. The other variants are back. All
right, the other variants are below, but yes.
Way below.
No, okay, number one is Blue-Red Delver. That's the deck with the target on its head. It's probably going to be the most represented deck at Grand Prix New Jersey. Why is this deck so good? I guess we've been talking about it a bunch. Monastery Swisspear, best one drop in the format. Delver, other best one drop in the format. Actually, no, Treasure Cruise, best one drop in the format.
Well, it's so good because it's super fast. All its spells are super efficient.
Hyper efficient.
And it gets to play Treasure Cruise, so it just gets to draw a lot of cards also. Like, it has Treasure Cruise and Brainstorm.
So it's just got
like Ponder. So, like, when the games go long, you just get to find, like, your long game cards pretty often.
Right.
The other thing is, you think about like velocity of, like, playing cards. Like, Treasure Cruise in this deck, when you Treasure Cruise and draw 3-1 drops, you do three things you're gonna do the next turn. When you play Treasure Cruise in a deck and you draw, like, Treasure Cruise in a deck like Stoneblade, say, imagine you play Treasure Cruise. It's more like card selection, because you can't play all the cards at once.
Yeah, if you drew, like, two Lingering Souls and, like, a Jace or something, you're like,
You still only get to do one thing then.
So it takes three turns or four turns to realize that value. So imagine the power spike, if you think of, like, the kind of, like, charting, like, power spikes in Magic, right? Yeah. Treasure Cruise is still extremely powerful in all these decks, but you realize the full potential in one turn in this blue-red deck, because you get to play all the spells.
Yeah,
it takes several turns, so if you average it out, it's, like, just, it's at its best in this deck.
Right, let's say you just drew into, like, you know, a Pyromancer and, like, a couple of one-mana spells. Boom, you just added, like, four power to the board.
Yeah.
And those one-mana spells are dealt six, or also they're cantripping.
Right.
You know? So...
It's the ability to unload the full potential of Treasure Cruise all in one turn, which I think really puts it over the top in this deck. I do think it's interesting. Maybe it's possible Rug Delver could be good against Blue Red Delver, because the card Tarmogoyf is actually probably pretty good. I'm not sure. I could see, like, as an asterisk, like, Rug Delver somehow finagling its way
against
into this,
like, Swift Spear.
Yeah, like, okay. Swift Spear does not win against Ugloyf.
Yeah.
Right. At least in the pre Treasure Cruise turns.
Right.
Because
they're like, all right, I'm going to play all these spells so this Swift Spear is big. And then you're like, well,
my Goyf's now big also. Yeah,
my Tarmogoyf's just naturally big.
No, so, I think the, like, weakness of the Delver deck is, well, first of all, somebody can figure out how to make a Chalice of the Void deck, because Chalice is absurd against it.
Okay.
But I think the problem with that is it's impossible to build a Chalice deck that is playable when you don't have Chalice, because then you don't have a deck full of, one mana
like
spells.
Is there, like, a
Snacks
deck?
No, the issue, how to hit the point exactly, it's like, I can play Chalice to, if you look at the list of the best cards in Legacy, right, it's like, 10 different one drops are on that list, right? Yeah. So, and most decks are playing 12 to 16 extremely powerful one mana cards.
Right.
So you forego playing any of those in your deck. Well,
yeah.
Now your deck.
So your deck is, just garbage when you don't have Chalice.
And oftentimes you don't play Chalice until, like, turn 2
just
or turn 3.
It's too late. So, like, if somebody can figure out how to make Chalice work like that, that's going to be absurd for the format. But barring that, the way you want to beat Delver is have a bunch of one-mana removal spells and then non-multiple threats.
Yeah.
So a bunch of one-mana removals and Tarmogoyf is the way you would want to beat this deck.
So maybe even
Tarmogoyf Tarmogoyf's and True Name Nemesis and just beat down? Maybe Stoneforge? No, it's going to be Stoneforge.
You know what Stoneforge's deck? Maybe there's some kind of
Zoo
variant?
If you play Stoneforge and Tarmogoyf, like, the fact that you could stick, like, your threat your Jit or whatever onto your Tarmogoyf and it can't get bolted is pretty good, right?
Sure, it just takes a lot of turns to set up.
Yeah, I guess so. But People, you're going to see a lot of new brews, and I wouldn't be surprised if people do come up with some pretty sweet lists just to specifically beat Blue Red Delver.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are going crazy. People are playing Electricory.
Sure.
Just so that they have a good matchup in the mirror, which is insane.
Yeah, I mean, the other way to beat it is also just take advantage of them cutting things like spell pierces or like cutting dazes because they're bad in the mirror. And just
play,
not expensive spells, because they're just going to kill you, but you just play combo. You play an aggressive, fast combo deck like Sneak and Show.
Play Sneak and Show and Storm. And this is also, again, if you play Sneak and Show and just jam, right, you don't want Dig Through Time, you don't want to play Control Roll, just jam, because they've cut all the cards that stop you from jamming.
Yeah.
Right, because
so build your deck to be as good of a turn two or turn three Sneak and Show deck as you can be.
Because that deck is just cutting a bunch of these, like, cheap. They're cutting disruptive elements just so they can just play all these one mana cards that are just like burn spells or whatever, cantrips.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that was our number one. Let's just kind of quickly go over the top eight list again. This was pretty extensive talk because, of course, we have Grand Prix New Jersey coming up. We have number eight, Reanimator. Number seven, Elves. Number six, Death and Taxes. Number five, Sneak and Show. Number four, Storm. Number three, Miracles. Number two, Stoneblade. And, of course, number one, big fat target on its head, Blue Red Delver. So that was our top eight. I'd like to thank Tom Martell for joining us. And, of course, Josh Arnold-Leighton and Darksteel Humphrey. I'm Paul Cheon. Thanks for watching Magic TV.